to see you here today. I'm very happy to be here on the 10th annual Media Center Showcase. All right. My name is Professor Louis Grasso. I know most of you, but there are a few people I don't know. I run the Media Studies program at University College. The program's over 30 years old, probably 34 years old by now. We offer about 26 courses in radio, television, journalism, and film a semester. You're welcome to take those courses as open electives or as part of the major, hopefully as part of the major. There are about 111 people in the major. There's about maybe 50 plus here. So just to give you an idea of the size of the program, it's really one of the bigger small programs, I like to say, at the college. The Media Studies program is part of the School of Liberal Arts. Now the college is divided up into schools, you know, business, health and natural sciences, social sciences, and there's the School of Liberal Arts. And right now we're very honored to have the Dean of the School of Liberal Arts here to welcome you. She's very supportive of the program in terms of budgeting and staffing and getting room assignments. Please welcome our Dean, Dr. Tamara Joshi.
I'm not sure about that budget comment. I'm not sure how much sway I have with budget.
I got the plug.
Well, I am so looking forward to hearing your presentations today. We look forward to this event every year, and your work is amazing. It needs to be shown and to be viewed by as many people as possible, so I am very, very delighted to be here. Well, how many of you are just so swamped right now, you don't know what day it is? I feel like that incredibly right now. I feel like we're all sort of running in place, right? We're sort of going at a mile a minute or 100 miles an hour, and we're just not taking time to nurture ourselves a little bit, and I think we all need to do that, but we all need to take time out, and this is an opportunity to just take a time out during our day and to celebrate the work that you've been doing this semester. So this is very important, just to slow down and to get together, view work, and to really celebrate your accomplishments, because you have accomplished a lot. And sometimes when we're going at 100 miles an hour, we don't see what we're actually accomplishing. So this is a great day for that. Well, before I turn the floor back over, I think it's to Professor Perotta, I would like to take this moment to recognize and to thank all of your wonderful professors for working with you this term, and to just show them some appreciation and love, which they sometimes don't get enough of in their hard work throughout the semester. So please join me in thanking them. So, at any rate, let the show begin, and good luck to everyone in your projects.
Thank you very much, Dean Joshi. We're going to move right along because we want to keep these presentations between 12 and 15 minutes long, so you see a lot of what's going on in the program. We have a lot of things to do. We have journalism, we have film studies, we have radio and television production, we have script writing, a whole host of things, and we have a performance later on toward the end. So right now I'm going to introduce to you the department chair of Communication and the Arts, and the teacher of the journalism courses, and also the advisor to the Impact. Any more hats you wear? Please welcome Professor Perotta.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks for coming. I'll speak swiftly and quickly so we can get on. We're getting booted right. Today we're going to talk about navigating political journalism, which I'm sure, as you know, is a real hot topic just in the country today. I don't think I've ever seen college students so involved politically in what's going on, maybe in a really, really long time. Maybe not in my adult life. So what we're going to talk about today is a concept called localization. Now, what is localization? It's something that every single media outlet practices. You might think, well, we're a college newspaper, we're located in New York, we cannot talk about national issues. And that's really the incorrect thought process. Every media outlet begins as a regional outlet, as a college newspaper. What localization does is we take a national issue and we try to bring it to your area and give your region's perspective on what things are going on. And that's why you see national news on your local broadcast, and you can see national news in your college newspapers. So the impact over the past few years has really tried to get more involved in the national scene by taking what's going on in the world and bringing it to the campus. And a lot of the journalism students and the production students have been teaming up to create these video packages, and we've been having a lot of fun doing it. So I'd like to introduce our managing editor, Nora Grace Rose. Nora, please. As of 48 hours ago, is now an employee of Complex Magazine to continue her music television career. Go ahead, Nora.
Hi. So basically, like you were saying, we try to take stories and localize them to the campus. And sometimes it's easier than others because, you know, we get obviously a lot of different, we have a lot of diversity at Mercy College, but sometimes people aren't always willing to talk about their opinion. The main thing that we try to do with our videos and all our stories is just make sure to have unbiased reporting. And just make sure we get as many, you know, inputs as we can and perspectives.
So. Okay, we gotta get the video up.
There are over 800,000 individuals in the United States whose freedom are being threatened by President Trump and his administration. DACA, a Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, was created by former President Barack Obama and his administration in 2012. These individuals were brought to the U.S. illegally as children by their families.
I have a few views about Trump ending DACA. I feel like it's really not fair because children have been spending their whole lives getting their education, trying to make it through in the States, and now having it taken away from them, it's just not right.
We're supposed to be the land of the free and the home of the brave, so we're promoting an image that other countries see as great, but only for countries that can economically benefit the country.
Under DACA, they were given a social security number. This allowed them to work, go to school, and even own a house or business.
DACA is a big problem, and as an immigrant myself, I think it's gonna affect a lot of students, a lot of people, children that came here, not on their own, they were brought by their parents. They've been here, this is all they know. This is home to them.
Many immigrants fear if Congress does not find a way to make it legal, then they will be deported.
To be honest, it's a little disappointing because a lot of kids who work really hard, who are trying to make a living to support themselves financially, it is very heartbreaking.
In September, President Trump and his administration announced that Congress should come up with a legitimate way to reestablish the policy before DACA expires in March 2018.
It's also a closed line of subject, so I feel like I might know someone that is just not willing to share.
Mercy College says they are firm in standing with the Dreamers. The college suggested places in the various boroughs for students under DACA to speak to local organizations for advice and assistance.
Students are here in college. They've been here since they were 2 years old. What do they know about Puerto Rico, wherever it is that you're going to take them? This is their home, and they should be treated as such, as citizens.
By March 2018, the Dreamers will know if they will be able to continue living the American dream or will be forced back into the shadows of uncertainty.
So, I'd like to bring up Karen and Chloe, who shot the video, and just to talk for 2 quick minutes. Thank you, ladies. Thank you, ladies. And you might think, okay, well, we need people to interview, so let's run out, let's grab them, easy peasy. It's not that easy when politically you're trying to do a story to get people to go on the record, and they can maybe tell you a quick anecdote about it.
I'm Chloe, I'm the one that filmed this. Definitely going about it on campus isn't the easiest. College kids really don't want to stop and talk. It's kind of hard. So if you do see us, you should stop and talk to us. But trying to get kids involved in politics isn't always easy as well. A lot of people, when we asked them, had no idea what DACA even was. So we're just definitely trying to get people more aware about politics on campus.
Yeah. I think it's important to be educated, and that's why we do videos like this, because we don't want you to be in a situation where someone's asking you, like, what do you think about this, and you actually don't know what they're talking about. So these videos are very informative for everybody as well, and it's really fun and tedious to work on it, but I think Chloe does a good job filming everything and getting people to talk and feel comfortable, so that's also really important. And, I'm just happy the Impact gives us that platform to share with all you guys.
We've had a lot of situations where students were very aware of what was going on, but said, I don't want my viewpoint being filmed. And that really becomes the real challenge as a journalist of, you know, you've done the research, you know what the story is, and then you find sources who would, you know, be perfect for your project, and then they back off and say, I don't want to be on the film. So we're probably looking at a 20% hit rate of people we ask, maybe?
Less
than 20%. So it's a job about persistence. Okay, that's all we have. Thank you very much.
Professor John Vucevic teaches radio production and video editing, and teaches Media in America. He teaches understanding media technology. He's here today to show us some of the work that's going on in his video editing classes, and some of the work that's
Angela
happening.
Angela Popovic hitting the post project.
And some of the work that's happening in his radio classes. Please welcome Professor John Vucevic.
That was good. You totally have me off my game now. I didn't get a chance to psych up. All right, so at any rate, I'm going to talk a little bit about radio. There's a couple of levels of radio, and we'll talk about it some other time. But basically, intro radio, learn the basics. Advanced levels are to now specialize and hone your skills. So what I have here are a couple examples of the Radio 1 projects. The first one you're going to hear is more of a technique, but it incorporates a lot of the basic skills you need, such as operating the board, announcing. Professor Trent will probably comment on some of the announcing, but it's a lot of people, it's their first times really listening to themselves, and everybody knows, everybody knows they hate themselves when they hear their own voices, right? I mean, it's like, oh my God, it's my voice! Because you don't really hear, the way you hear yourself isn't the way everyone else hears you. So there's that to get over, there's operating the equipment. And this first is really a skill, but it incorporates a lot of the basics. So it's called hitting the post. It's a technique used where someone will announce over what's just a long musical introduction for some purpose. So Jaylis, if you will, remember these are some
Angela Popovic, Hitting the Post Project, Take 9.
Some of the first times people are really doing any of this.
You're listening to the number one music station in the Lower Hudson Valley, WMCR 108.1 FM. I can't believe it's that time of year again. Alice Cooper is returning to the area for his Halloween spectacular. Alice Cooper will be live in concert at the Westchester County Center Tuesday, October 31st. The doors will open at 7 p.m. and all ages are welcome. It's going to be classic Alice Cooper, and he's here Halloween night. If you've never seen Alice Cooper live in concert, this is your chance. I promise you won't regret it. The tickets are on sale now, but if you're the 108th caller, you'll win a pair of tickets to the show and be VIP guests of WMCR for the concert after party. So be the 108th caller to win the free tickets and VIP guest passes, or buy your tickets at the County Center or at Ticketmaster.com. Again, it's Alice Cooper live in concert October 31st at the Westchester County Center. You don't want to miss this.
Well, she cut her off a little soon.
Sorry.
That's okay, it's fine. But she did it. Basically, there was going to be a snap on the drums and the song would begin, and that's known as hitting the post. Again, for a lot of students, this is the first time they're putting any of this together and getting any of this recorded. So, there's a little room for improvement. And the next one is actually the first assignment. You write it, you create it, you produce it with the help of the lab partner. It gets created. So the next example is something called a public service announcement. This is not selling a thing or a service. This is kind of selling a concept, a lot like don't do drugs, all right? Or don't drink and drive, one of those types of things. So if you will, the next one is by Christine
Francesca, PSA Halloween Time Tips, Take 11. Hey you, yeah you, don't you know what time of year it is? Halloween is just around the bend, and it's a good time for creatures of all ages. But let's not forget the safety tips for all the kiddies. It is important for everyone to know the general safety to make sure everyone can enjoy this holiday season. We're sure your kids know not to go into strangers' houses, that they should travel in groups, and they should throw out all open goodies. But do they know all of the pedestrian safety tips and costume safety tips? Do they know the general tips for emergency situations? You should always make sure that they do. Reach out to your local police departments for a full list of Halloween safety tips and local Halloween safety events for safe and happy trick-or-treating experiences. Make sure every little monster is doing the right thing this Halloween. The only scares we need are from the ghosts. This message is brought to you by Sleepy Hollow and Irvington Police Departments.
And again, that was written and produced by Christy. Francesca was her lab partner, was actually the person reading it, and really it was Christy's call whether or not, you know, Francesca did a good enough job. How many times did she make you redo it? Don't tell me. It's all right. So in Radio 2, just very quickly, what we would do from here is take these skills and advance on them. Also in the radio journalism class, we would advance those skills. Radio journalism actually would focus mostly on news format, man in the street type interviews, that type of stuff. And the Radio 2, you create your own radio station. And every position, with the exception of me as general manager, is filled by you. So I don't have any examples of that, but what we look to do there is basically work the entire semester creating every bit of content except for the music. And maybe one day we'll do that too, but everything is done by you. Every sound, every element is created by you. All right? So with that, I'll move on to editing. And what I don't do is I don't teach you software, okay? So what, just hang on to it. What I'm trying to do is teach you how to edit, and editing's up here, all right? Everything else is just a tool, but I mean, you can't really call yourself a carpenter if you can't drive a nail straight. So you do have to know your tools, but you don't just learn how to swing one hammer. And if that's what you know, well, you're not really an editor, you're an equipment operator. Dare I say the horrible phrase we hate so much, button pushers. Know what happened, know why you're pushing the button, not because somebody told you to do it, all right? So you do have to know your tools. This is one of the first projects that we work on. Very basic, just telling a very simple story. I'm going to show you another version of it that's a little bit more advanced. It's almost the same story, but there's a little difference. All right, so if we're going to play Francesca's and then we're going to play Caroline's. So we're just going to play them back to back.
Hey, how'd you do?
I don't know. I think I did okay.
What do you mean you think you did okay? You studied, didn't you?
Yeah, but some of the questions they asked, I don't know.
I'm sure you did fine. You had my notes.
I missed a few classes. I just hope I passed.
I'm sure you passed. Hey, why don't we grab lunch, my treat?
Oh, sure. Yeah, let's go.
Actually, hold up, don't play Carolyn's. You can queue up Carolyn's. This footage was actually shot by Professor Grosso's field class, and we use it in our editing class, and that's kind of the whole, and I'm sure he's gonna talk about it more, the whole integration of the program, where it's not just one thing, one class, and that's it and done. No, it's got a life beyond that. So what happened here is, this is a script that's been used before, but you're gonna see some problems where that nice clean edit, actually when you edit it slightly differently, you're gonna see some problems because the pace that you heard it at in this version is about the pace it was supposed to be done at. But one of our actors was responding like this, instead of, oh yeah, I don't know, I think I did okay. It was like, I think I did okay. So you're gonna see one of the challenges when we try to do that in a split screen or an inset screen. So this one is done by Caroline, I'm sorry, and this was her solution to some of that. It's gonna look very similar, a little different.
Hey, how'd you do?
I don't know. I think I did okay.
What do you mean you think you did okay? You studied, didn't you?
Yeah, but some of the questions they asked, I don't know.
I'm sure you did fine. You had my notes.
Yeah, I mean, I missed a few classes. I just hope I did okay.
I'm sure you passed. I'm sure you did fine. Hey, let's go grab lunch. My treat.
Oh, okay, let's go. Sure.
Okay, and basically, it's two different ways to tell the same story and overcome a few different problems. I'm just going to show a few seconds of this. I'm going to show maybe the first 30 seconds or so of it, and then just stop it, and I'll explain what's going on.
Hello, welcome to the Mornings with Mark. I'm your host, Mark. My guest today is Caroline. She's from Oregon, so tell me a bit about Oregon.
Well, it is illegal to pump your own gas.
You mean like a state offense, like you can go to jail or fined for it?
You don't go to jail for it if like you're pumping on gas, but you can get fined, I think. But if you've grown up in Oregon, you lived there your whole life, you don't know how to pump your own gas.
So this is something that's been going on for a while. It's not like they just added it this year or anything.
No, it's far as long as I know, it's been a law.
Any reason they decided to outlaw this?
I don't even know if it was law, like, at one point in Oregon that you were, like, able to pump your own gas. Mm-hmm. I just know that it's been like that as long as I can remember.
Okay,
did you ever get paid to pump gas?
Okay, so far it looks just, so what's the big deal with this? This just looks like a regular, you know, TV One type interview, and what's so unique about it? The thing is, this was shot as ISOs, and what you're seeing here is that show cut together from three different angles. And the way this particular one was done with what's called a multi-clip edit. So three streams are simultaneously going, and Kayla was switching this live as though it were three cameras, but it's pre-recorded. So everything you see here, you know, she's purposely edited to look not very polished, to have it feel live. And that's just another aspect. Some, you know, everybody looks at editing like, oh, it's this thing to make this other thing perfect. No, it's to make it look believable. I mean, I guess we can argue the aesthetics. But I just want to show you some of the techniques and some of the advanced abilities, especially thanks to the dean, as much as she says that she doesn't know about the budget. Thank you so much for some of the recent upgrades. I just want to show you two other things. And again, this was shot by Professor Grasso in another class. I just want to show two other quick things. Something else, again, they were shot in other classes. These are projects that students are currently working on. So these are kind of the examples. And this kind of speaks for itself. It's a very quick scene.
Hey, sis, what are you doing?
Nothing. I was just playing with this robe. You're not supposed to be into the scene.
You know you're not supposed to be just saying things going wild. Terry, what is wrong with you?
Come on, Terry. I'm just playing.
Put him back to normal.
Well,
no.
Fine.
So if you're not sure what's going on, I think you're going to know what's going to happen in a minute.
I was going to feed this robe into Lucy. You know you're not supposed to feed just saying things you caught in the wild.
Terry, what is wrong with you?
Come on, Terry. I was just playing around.
Put it back to normal.
Well,
now.
Fine.
Okay, and through the magic of editing, we have our finished shot.
Hey, sis, what are you doing?
Nothing, I was just playing with the wildlife around here. I was going to feed this robot to Lucy.
You know you're not supposed to feed just saying things to go in the wild. Terry, what is wrong with you?
Come on, Tori, I was just playing around.
Put him back to normal.
Well,
now.
Fine.
And obviously it's the same actress, and, you know, playing twins. I only got a few more minutes, so I'm going to finish up with the other thing they're working on. Editing also has become, there's been more demands on the editors. And where typically things have been sent off to special effects teams, now more stuff is being required to be done by the editor. So I got this one last example. I think we'll get in just under the wire. It's called the composite shot. And again, you'll see just some basic stuff. And actually, this is just what we call a plate shot. We have screen acting to a green screen right now? What's he doing? Well, again, you have to kind of think in layers. Here's a second shot. Here's Sarai. She's kind of, and as you notice, there's a lot of wrinkles and stuff and edges, but we don't care about that. Again, we're thinking about the setup of the shot and kind of knowing where we're going to end up. And then this is basically the assembled shot.
Not much. What's up with you?
I don't know. I'm just feeling a little bit down.
Cheer up.
And then we did a little bit more of a refined shot, but you can...
Hey, what's up?
She's a little smaller, color corrected a little bit more.
I'm just feeling a little bit down.
Well, cheer up.
Okay. And then this last little bit is just the shot deconstructed,
hey,
so you get a sense of how it was actually composed. And there's a lot of stuff going on here. And some of the techniques that were used and some of the manipulation. Where this was typically done by a special effects team, now it's being called upon the editor. So what you need to know and the set of tools is expanding. So, and we're trying to bring all of that stuff to you and more, and I'm out of time. So.
Up next, we'll try to keep within the time slots. It's really important. So up next, we have Professor Steven DeRosa. Professor DeRosa teaches a whole slew of film studies classes for us in the media studies program. This semester, he tried out a course called Hitchcock Disciples. And please welcome Professor Steven DeRosa.
As Professor Grosso mentioned, this semester, I'm teaching a course called Hitchcock Disciples. I was really excited when it was about a year ago that he asked me if I would consider doing a topics course, and the course would be entirely focused on one director for the entire semester. And he mentioned that my book, Writing with Hitchcock, would be the text, and who wouldn't jump at that opportunity? So I'm happy I was able to put this together. Another thing I wanted to do with this course was to bring my students to a theater to see films on the big screen with an audience. So I arranged with the head programmer at Alamo Drafthouse in Yonkers to screen a few films during the semester on the nights of my course, so that the students could go in and see the films with an audience, so you get the full reactions and the responses of having a crowd there. And then there was a Q&A discussion period afterward. So the discussions in the class have been wonderful. We're going through Hitchcock, his work with certain collaborators. We're getting everything from the technical side to the analytic side, psychoanalytic perspectives on his films, feminist perspectives on his films. And so there was really no way to kind of present this, the kind of discussions that we're doing in the class, other than to make a film. And Caroline Newman is here to kind of present the film that she appears in and plays a big part in making with one of her classmates.
Okay, so basically, this little movie that we created took place over a couple of weeks. We shot some footage while we were at the Alamo, and then later on in the class throughout the semester, there's different things in there. And that's basically all I'm going to tell you, because everything else is in the little clip that we made. So hope you enjoy it.
Artistic aspects of film, but also how it reflects upon society and influences society. I've always been kind of aware of that. And I wanted to kind of expand that knowledge. And ever since I've been involved in it, it really has. It's really made me reflect on what is constantly, we're surrounded by media, and we're surrounded by visual representations of women and men and our world, and just knowing where they come from and how they've evolved over time is incredibly interesting.
Even now, after I've been doing this for 3 years, I know all the hard work it takes to put even just like a 30-second thing on screen. And even with that film I worked on before I even came here, it seemed like we were working on one specific scene from one shot and one angle for like 4 hours, because we're working with one camera. And so like I've learned to appreciate all the hard work people go into. And so like it's different to go to film classes, you just see like the final edit. And like a lot of my film classes, we don't learn about, oh, how was this made, where was it shot, how long did it take, what kind of the budget was, or anything like that. And that stuff I like to know because I can appreciate the film even more. Well, first of all, it's a really fun class because not only do we get to watch and focus on like one director and that director's work, but also you've brought in scripts and screenplays, and we've seen the films at the Alamo, which I think it's a totally completely different experience.
And going to the Alamo obviously was really interesting because if we're able to go and just experience the films on a huge screen, it just draws you in and it makes you feel the entire experience. It's like seeing the film for the first time. And then afterwards, having more people than in our class, more people with different perspectives, and it broadens the mindset, you know, how you really see his films. The shadow of a doubt, I'm like going from there to what? Let's say Rear Window, right? You know, you just see how he represents his women. He makes them central to the story. If you remove the women from Hitchcock's stories, nothing happens, really, because they drive the story. He puts them there for a reason, to make a statement, and especially for that time period, I feel like that's very, you know, that's different, because during his time, and when films were being made all around him, women were passive, women were objects, women were sexualized, women were, you know, basically not in charge of their own destiny.
Those characters are definitely different, especially in, like, To Catch a Thief. I noticed that a lot. Even like that drive scene when they're driving down the hillside, or how like she, like the Grace Kelly character took, I noticed like she kind of took more control over a lot of the situations. It was probably maybe her idea or close to it for the Cary Grant character to go to the costume party with them and dress up and be right there, and the whole switch and Grace Kelly characters again in Rear Window. She's the one that went into the apartment and snuck the wedding band on her finger. The James Stewart character wasn't thinking that he could have a relationship with her. She wears dresses, so she only wears ones, but they're like $1,000 dresses. She goes to these runway shows, but then she proved him wrong, saying she can get down and dirty, basically, just to prove that a man murdered his wife.
It's like hegemonic negotiation in a way, because he uses the way that we perceive male protagonists as central to a story and we follow them. But then he creates this situation where they can't get by without this woman. They can't make it without her. And that makes us think, oh no, she's necessary. She's not a distraction, she's necessary. That I think is very, very interesting, because you don't see that with a lot of directors. You see them kind of, the hero gets distracted by them, and then, you know, is kind of upset about it, and finally focuses on his goal. And it's all about him. But with these women, you're watching them develop into active, just heroes. You know, they become heroes in their own way throughout his films. Even if that means them not saving the day, they bring out the best in the male protagonist, such as in North by Northwest, you know. But this is a selfish man, he's average, he's a liar, he's a salesman, he's just not particularly ethically sound, and here's this woman, and he starts to care for her. And of course, he's threatened by her because she's mysterious, but ultimately, it comes down to the fact that she brings out humanity in him. She brings out something natural in him. And saving her brings him into this whole other part of his life. He's not in his gray suit anymore at the end of the film. He's completely transcended his existence as the sleazy salesman. And he's become a hero.
Man, I know, like, in North by Northwest, we were at the Alamo, and, like, I was, like, full on, like, leaning back in my seat, and I was, like, doing this. I'm, like, and I was completely freaking out because I thought he was going to drop at one point because I really saw one of the bad guys slip and fell off someone's ear or something at Mount Rushmore. And so I thought, like, for sure if she was going to fall or she was going to slip or something, I was kind of half expecting for her to fall to her death because it is Hitchcock, and he does have death in his films. And I was expecting it, and then, like, for him just to reach down and grab her and then pull her right up on the train. If I look at it from an editing view, that was really cool editing. It was really nice, like, the continuity was really nice. I thought it was really cool. But, like, if I'm just, like, watching it as a viewer, especially my first time, I get really into it. I, like, immediately set up, like, what happened? You could have done the same editing technique if you did it, like, pull her up, hug her, and kiss her, and then when they released the kiss, they were on the train. You could have done the same thing, but not give us, like, a little mini heart attack in the process.
A lot of what he did was just, everything was purposeful. You know, like, if you see a shadow, you know, like, there's something that we're supposed to be doubting, or if you see the contrast between the light and dark, there's a reason for it. If the camera is tracking all the way around the room, and, you know, it happens to zero in on someone really quickly, you know, like, you're going to take note of that, and their expression is something that you're meant to identify with or respond to. It was helpful when looking at his films to know, like, how to break down his scenes piece by piece and just, you know, try to figure out what he could mean by them, by his choices.
I really like how We the whole class, we just sat down, and I ended up having to write on the board, and we were all just talking about, like, what the different motifs were in each movie, or the different storylines and all that kind of stuff, and then we started noticing all the connections.
For instance, the use of hands. I always thought this was so fascinating, how, like, the hands in so many of the films, like, are meant to show, like, they reveal more than the faces do in many ways. You know, someone can completely deadpan, but if they're gripping their hands, or if they're, you know, like, they've cut themselves, then all of a sudden, you know, we have a different response to it. You know, like, we can't read them at first, but their hands show us what they're feeling. And, you know, if it's not their hands, then it's their feet. And the trouble with Harry, there you go, taking off the shoes, and the, what are these, like, these brightly colored socks are just there, and, you know, he focuses on them every now and then. It's interesting to see what he finds important, you know, because he does them purposefully. It's cool to see how in our society today, you know, obviously there's a lot to do with identity and figuring yourself out, especially with younger students. But it's cool to see how his characters express themselves. And, you know, for instance, Grace Kelly becoming, you know, this active woman after being, you know, this fashionista in Rear Window, you know, she becomes an adventurer. She adventures out, and in her dress, she climbs up this fire escape, and it just shows what you can do. You know, it shows what's possible, and in society today, I feel like that's what it's all about. It's all about what's possible for you. You know, you can still express yourself, you can still be individual, but you don't have to be a certain kind of individual. You don't have to conform to societal standards of behavior or gender or sexuality. And you don't have to insist that everyone else does either. So in that sense, yeah, I do see connections between today's society and the films that we view.
In the use of our plastic, are rather limited. It appears to be time to say goodnight. Next week, we should be back with another story.
Negatives, like, it's old-fashioned. old-fashioned cameras. I used to do this all the time. Just hold up to lights and look at it.
Sounds familiar.
Is this from,
Everything is good about the class.
You have your other winners who did the adaptation, right?
Any last questions for Joel?
I believe his name is Josh.
Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we bring you a story about murder.
We just saw this.
That's an outtake.
Is this North by Northwest? No. It is?
Yeah. He's constantly commenting and celebrating the human condition, so how could it not be relevant?
Exactly.
Give a flavor of what's going on in the class, the kind of this really intense discussions that we're having. And what I really loved about Caroline and Helen is you really get to see both perspectives. You have from Helen was giving so much of the analytical side. She's a film and culture concentration major, and Caroline, being a television production major, she really focused so much more on the technical side. So you can see how each one of your concentrations really kind of melds together. And of course, so if you'd like to have a class like that in the spring, I'm teaching Hollywood's Golden Age, and we will be going to Alamo, so sign up.
Quite impressive. I mean, that was put together by the students. I really appreciate that. Keeping with the program, that was a 15-minute presentation. Our next presentation is Professor Jay Schneider. Professor Schneider teaches in the Media Studies program. She also teaches the Communication Studies program as well, public relations courses and advertising courses and publicity courses, etc. Please welcome Professor Jay Schneider.
As Professor Grasso said, some of the courses that I teach are Media Studies courses as well as Comm Studies. And today I'm going to take you through the work of a few of the Comm Studies courses that we have been working on since last spring of 2017 and also this fall. And the first one is intercultural communication. Be communicators in this world. It's an awareness, as actually I believe it was Helen who said it in that film, that identity is such an important part of what we do and who we are now. And understanding yourself and being self-reflexive in terms of your identity is really critical in being able to provide a platform for later communications. So whether it's communications with other people from other cultures, or in the workplace, or in sort of global politics, you name it, right? Communication is sort of key. So understanding what we do, one of the projects that we do is an identity mosaic, and we understand all of the different categories of sort of identities, and we can have multiple identities at any one time. We also look in this course at the impact of power, culture, and certainly in this country, how that sort of frames our identities, what the culture industries, I myself worked for one for 20 years, many of them, how they exemplify the popular culture, but they also amplify it for their own sort of personal gain. And then what that means in terms of our relations external to the U.S., right? This idea of imperialism and how we kind of promote those notions. So how does one person find their place in the U.S.? And that's kind of what we try to do, is identify the roots and sort of the origins of all of the reasons and ways that prejudice, stereotypes can form and things like that. So for intercultural communication, it's really about looking and understanding yourself and your place in society, right? So how do you get there? One of the things that we do is what we call an identity mosaic. And I'm going to show you the work of two students. Donnell is in the back. Where are you, Donnell? Okay. I'm going to show you a little bit of his work, and maybe he can talk a little bit about it. The whole object. Oh, wait, you don't have to get out of that.
Sorry.
Yeah, you can just go to. Just pop that up. Yeah. The first tab. So, yeah. So Donnell will show you a little bit about what his journey has been like.
On January 9th, 1993, a star was born. Or at least that's what my parents told me. My name is Donnell Kwame Scott, and I'm 24 years old. I was born in Brooklyn, New York, but spent the first 4 to 5 years of my life living in Bennettsville, South Carolina. I am back in Brooklyn where I feel like I belong. Don't get me wrong though, I still love South Carolina and visit there almost every Thanksgiving and Christmas, but Brooklyn will always be home to me. Like almost everyone in this world, it took two people to create the person that is me. My mom, Sheila Kusa, and my dad, Darnell Isaiah Scott. I love my parents both equally, and they kept me very close to them and sheltered for most of my childhood. But it wasn't until I got old enough to begin to understand things and see the world in a more mature manner that I started to get out and do things on my own. I thank them every chance I get for allowing me to make mistakes and find different ways of figuring things out. I grew up with two brothers, Stefan and Xavier. Stefan is my older brother and is pursuing his dreams in Texas. And my younger brother, Xavier, passed away at the age of 17. But growing up with two brothers taught me a sense of toughness and how to live with a chip on my shoulder. We were always competing at almost everything, anything you can think of. In my life, there were a series of experiences that helped shape the person that is me today. My graduation from high school, being the second in my family to enter college, my little brother's death, my grandmother's death, my dad's mom, my grandfather's death, my mother's dad, all set me up to be able to view the world in a different lens. I feel as if none of those things happened, along with the teachings of my parents, my brain would probably be mush, and I wouldn't be able to handle the things that life threw at me. And also, because of those things, I am a free spirit who is very opinionated, questions almost everything, goal-oriented, has a collectivist nature with friends and family, and an individualist when it comes to achieving what I want. Once again, my name is Darnell Kwame Scott, and this is who I am.
Donnell, do you want to just talk for a quick second, you can stand up where you are, about what that was like to put something like that together?
It was very different because I actually got to learn a lot about my family, and it actually helped me figure out that I definitely keep family and friends very high on my values like list. And creating the video was just fun as a whole. I like doing this stuff.
The next one I wanted to show you was, you know, we have 25 kids in class every semester that we teach it, and so you can imagine the mosaic that just something like that creates in and of itself. So I'd like to show the next example of a portion of Santiago Corral's experience as a student who's visiting here, and a little bit about, you know, the terms that we use, individualism, collectivist nature, all of these things are important. And what does it look like from someone who's actually here for a period of time? Santiago's in the front, and he can tell us about that in just a sec.
We Argentinians have one typical food that identifies us all unanimously, and that is our barbecue, which happens a lot. Here, the demographic imperative takes place in the sense that, although there are barbecues in America, and they're great, I don't feel the same as in my country when I go to one. I can say that I'm a universalist person. I don't care where people are from, I have the capacity to learn from them, and even adopt certain types of traditions. But a barbecue is the only thing that, so far, I find irreplaceable. Because although I love a way of cooking, we basically eat everything of the animal we cook, and the most people find it creepy until they try it. It's not just the food itself. It means gathering with your family every Sunday, seeing your cousins who you don't usually see, so it is a lot more than just food. My grandparents have been married for 50 years and my parents for 25. I've been with my girlfriend for 2 years now, and out of all that time, a year and a half has been long distance, as I decided to attend college in the US. Probably, if I hadn't got my parents and grandparents as an example, I wouldn't have dared to do this. Coming to America is a great experience for me. I came to do what I love, and it made me realize how important my culture is for me. The most shocking thing that happened to me was trying to say hello to people here as I do back home, with a kiss. Everybody looked at me as if I was a freak, until I finally understood. Here it's just a handshake or absolutely no contact at all. My own nonverbal behavior which is normal for me, was clearly inappropriate here, and that was the first indicator that I was far away from home. My values are the most important things in my life. If I had them taken away, I would feel as if I couldn't move on to my goals and expectations. I need them all. Be a good person, becoming educated, being honest, working hard, being independent, being productive. Most important of all, don't just look to help yourself. Help the world, and the world will eventually help you.
Okay, so, yeah, having to make this identity mosaic made me kind of review all my life, which I hadn't done, like, a lot of time, and maybe realize how important it is where you come from and who you are. And apart from that, I don't know, it made me realize how privileged I am to be able to live this experience, and I'm very thankful for that.
The next class I wanted to show you a little bit about was advanced practice of PR, and this is where the capstone for all of the comm classes kind of culminate in this. And here we look at real clients. We assemble a team of students who all represent different aspects of an agency, a communications agency, and try to solve real problems. Now, the thing about the classes that I teach is when you're sort of in the room, that's when the magic happens, right? Our products are kind of like after the fact, but really it's we're live, we're in front of a client, we're in front of someone trying to persuade. So it's the thinking that goes into it. And every year that I teach this class, the students come up with their own ideas. They came up with Covenant House as a client to try to see if there was a way to help them sort of change and understand how to refine their offering, right? Covenant House serves all of the homeless, many of the homeless youth in here. So a lot of what you see is just a lot of documentation and thinking and strategy and all of this stuff. But Emily might tell you a little bit about, here's one of her status updates about what this project is like.
Yeah, so this was a really interesting project, actually. So we were split into three groups, which was account management, which really dealt a lot with the client and did a lot of background research. There was strategy, who, you know, did a lot of thinking about the key strategic objectives and the insights that we had to provide in order to make conclusions about, like, where we can go for the client. And so I was in strategy, but I kind of actually ended up bouncing all over the place, because with a project like this, you kind of just want to make sure the client's always happy. So it was a lot of fun. We ended up having to narrow down our targets, which took a lot of work. I think we ended up changing them like three times, like, because of all the information we were getting from the client back and forth. But it ended up turning out to be really good. But we did hit a little bit of a roadblock, because once we were finished with PowerPoint with our deck, we were ready to present it to the client, and they were like, oh, actually, psych, we're cut, like, we have a huge scandal coming out, so we don't have the time for you anymore. So we were like, oh, okay. And
so we had a pivot.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what we did. Emily explains something that had happened for the first, it happens a lot, you know, in one's career, but it happened for the first time in this class. We actually had to lose a client. And it wasn't our own fault, but we were able to kind of pivot and do what we could. So then we focused on the impact, and we came up with some ideas for them, which, you know, we're happy to show you, those guys. We couldn't get into it as in details we wanted to, but we definitely kind of covered it. And last but not least, effective presentations, right? Like I said, this is where everything comes together. This is where your persuasive techniques and your ability to sell not only yourself and understand sort of yourself, which goes back to the first class, kind of all comes together. So this semester's project was to try to create a presentation to convince someone that, number one, they might have ghosts in their house, and then number two, that they can be the best people to kind of get over it. We do that by trying to present to them all kinds of ideas that will either increase or decrease their likelihood of accepting our ideas. We have to ask a lot of questions, and then the final product. And Christian and Daniela, maybe you can tell us a little bit about this. They developed Horseman's Realty.
Okay, well, this is tricky, because you're trying to sell something that, in reality, would anybody really buy a home where there's ghosts? Because I know I wouldn't. but we have to create a product where our product is going to, get rid of these ghosts and make you feel comfortable in your home, and you're not there. You shouldn't be. You should be comfortable in your home, and you're not alone. So that was what we were trying to get at. So one of the great things that they did in this presentation is some of the most key things. Establishing their own credibility was very important inside of that, right? And talking about this imaginary world where they would be ghost-free and it would be amazing. First, you have to introduce this idea of what a nightmare it would be and then what a solution it would be. They kept pulling meaningful data, right? Actual data that supports the idea that some people do believe in ghosts. So you tip from ghosts aren't real to, huh, maybe my house is haunted. And then they came up with a product and an offering and a solution, anticipating all the ways somebody might resist and pushing them right over that threshold to get to the next step. And products were just one part of it, but it was really the presentation. And like I said, when we're on in the room, it's all about the way they carry themselves, the what they do with their body language, how they present themselves, and they did a fantastic job. So that's it.
Thank you so much, Professor Schneider. Keeping with the 15-minute presentations, up next we have Professor Augusta McCarthy and his class, a scriptwriting class. It's not in the program, I'm sorry, it was a last-minute entry. And his students are doing a reading of a script that they were, a student-written script they're working on. So
hi, I'm Professor McCarthy, some of you I know. I teach screenwriting here. We're going to be having reading a script from last semester's screenwriting class. We also had another section this semester. So it's been, I wish I could have taken some of these other classes. They sound really fascinating. And a lot of the things that we practice in screenwriting does tie in story, character, identity. Some of the issues that you look at in some of your other classes, you can write fictional scripts about. So actually, next semester, there's another section, and there's some space left. There's some people signed up, but we need some more people to sign up in order for the class to run. So if you haven't taken any screenwriting classes, you can talk to me, you can talk to Professor Grasso, or Professor Parada, or you can talk to our administrative assistant, Jayliss Pichardo. You can email any of them. You can email me, prof.a.mccarthy@gmail.com. And we can work something out so that you know the fundamentals like screenplay format. So the script that we're going to read today is from Travis Archer. The scripts that we've done, some of them are about dating. There's a lot of college kids who date. So some of them are about love, some of them about murder. Some of them are about sweeter things. This is one that is in the style of Travis. So we're going to read it now. Okay, so can you just introduce yourselves?
All right. Hi there, my name is Albert Tignancini. I'm a computer arts and design major. I'm going to be taking part in Travis's lovely script here.
Thank you. So just say your name so they know what your names are.
Alfred.
How you doing? My name's Edward. Travis Archer, at your service.
Thank you.
Okay. Hi, I'm Lauren.
Lauren Butler, yeah?
Yes.
Okay, so these are our readers, and I'm going to do the narrator. Exterior Arctic mountain, day. The snow falls softly and slowly from the sky, and the cloud passes by, revealing a steep mountain near the Arctic bay. Bjork, the polar bear, is walking up the mountain on his four legs with his guardian, Narrington, the snowy white owl, flying right next to Bjork.
Bjork. Have you ever thought of doing something, you know, useful in your life instead of wandering around this wasteland doing nothing?
Hey, come on, man. Let me have my day off. I've been patrolling this land for months.
I'm just saying is all. It's a whole lot better than being lazy.
Bjork stops walking for a moment as Narrington lands on his shoulder. The polar bear lifts up his ear and hears a high-pitched feminine voice in the distance.
Help!
Huh?
Bjork and Narrington turn their heads and Bjork walks to the edge of the mountain. They see Anya, 16, the Eskimo princess, drowning in the Arctic Bay with the waves gusting through her face as she struggles to breathe.
Somebody, please, help me.
Oh, jeez.
What is that Eskimo girl doing in the Arctic?
Don't know for sure, but I bet she can't make it out here today on her own.
Bjork walks away from the edge until Narrington flies toward her.
Whoa, wait just a minute. Bjork, you can't just walk away from her when she's in danger.
Narrington lands on the snow as he stands in front of Bjork.
That girl needs our help, and we're the only one who can save her, you especially.
What are you talking about, Nar?
Bjork, don't you see? This could be a chance to claim your place in the animal kingdom, like how your father did, and his father, and his father before him, 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 and...
Get to the point, Arrington. You're starting to bore me.
What I mean by this is, you have to accept the responsibility of your role, no matter what the situation would be.
Okay, then.
Yorick jumps from the edge with Narrington flying off his shoulder and slides down the mountain towards the shore while he follows Narrington. He runs toward the bay and swims toward Anya with his 4 feet moving back and forth. Anya gasps in horror.
Oh no, not now.
Now calm down. It's okay. You're all right.
Anya screams loudly and swims away from Bjork with her arms moving back and forth until Bjork grabs her arm with his paw.
Hey, take it easy. You're gonna be all right.
Anya swipes her arm away from him and pushes the water with her hands as she turns her head around and closes her eyes.
Get away! Get away! Get away! Get away!
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Just a minute. I'm not gonna eat you.
Anya hits Bjork on his head with her oar repeatedly until he quickly grabs the oar with his paw.
Okay, please, calm down. Take it easy.
Don't eat me, please. I don't taste good.
He means no harm, child. Also, he doesn't like to eat humans, just so you know.
Relax. I'm not gonna eat you. I'm gonna get you out of here.
How?
Just climb on my back, and you'll be fine.
Are you sure about this?
Just get on.
Anya climbs on Bjork's back, and Bjork swims directly back to the shore, with Narrington flying with them.
By the way, I don't think we've been introduced yet. The name's Bjork, and that owl who's flying with me is Narrington, my guardian.
Greetings.
What's yours?
I'm Anya, the princess of my village.
A princess?
Mm-hmm.
You're the princess?
That's right.
Bjork walks out of the water as Anya jumps off his back. Bjork shakes his body to get the water off of him, and Anya shields her face from the water with her hands. Narrington lands on Bjork's shoulder.
What the heck are you doing out here?
Well, I just came out of here to explore this land, but as usual, I was supposed to be back at the village by sunset, and now I don't even know where I am anymore. Plus, I'm the last of the chiefs, and...
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Wait a minute. You're the last of the Eskimo chiefs?
Well, that's not good.
I gotta get you out of here and take you home. Here, climb on my back.
Anya climbs on his back, and Bjork walks up the slope of the snowy fields. Exterior wintry wasteland day. Bjork still walks on his four legs with Anya on his back. Narrington flies along with them.
And you shouldn't be out here anyways.
Well, why is that?
Because first of all, if you die out here, then the entire village will have no chief, and therefore there will be no order. And when there's no order, it would eventually fall into chaos. And I mean serious chaos. Second, there is another carnivorous animal out there who is absolutely nothing like me. In fact, you might even say that he's the polar opposite of me.
Haha, good one.
I know, right? Anyways, he's the kind of predator who slaughters every animal in sight and will stop at nothing until every last human animal who lives in this arctic is dead.
Wow, sounds to me that he's not a very nice animal at all.
Nice? Are you kidding? He's psychopathically evil.
He wants to invade this entire land for himself, but Bjork's father spent 20 years of bringing peace to this land and would claim it as his own. So he killed Bjork's father and mother for it when he was just a little cub.
Oh my god, all by himself?
That, and with this whole pack. Which is why, as the guardian of this land, I have to get you out of here before he comes.
But who is he? What is he?
Bjork stops walking and hears a disturbing howling noise in the distance. He turns his head and gasps.
That's who.
Wintuk, the large white wolf, is standing on the mountain. Then Wintuk pounces his way down the hilltops that are on the left and right side of him.
That's him, all right. That corrupted scavenger.
Anya, get behind me. I'll handle this.
Anya climbs off his back and stands behind Bjork. Narrington lands on his shoulder again. Wintuk lands on the snow, approaching Bjork out of the shadows with a sinister grin and a deep chuckle with his mouth closed.
Well, well, well. If it isn't the overstuffed mongrel and his fair-feathered friend. Bjork, is it? I see that you are ready to accept your demise.
Wintuk, what do you want?
Oh, I just dropped by to finish you off, to challenge you to the most life-threatening duel of your existence.
Bjork puts his front foot forward, still standing in front of Wintuk.
Not a chance in hell, you pale-faced mutt. Back off.
If we defeat you once, you will be sure to defeat you again.
Anya raises her spear above Bjork's back and points it at Wintuk. Wintuk looks at her with surprise.
And what do we have here?
Wintup walks past Bjork and approaches Anya. Anya gasps as she backs away from him.
I must say, Bjork, this two-legged morsel looks absolutely elegant, radiant, and good enough to eat.
Wintup leaps toward Anya. Bjork quickly grabs Wintup by the tail with his mouth and tosses him away from Anya.
Stay away from her, now.
Or what?
Slice you in half.
Bjork unsheathes his claws.
That sounds rather violent and grim for a sensitive mammal like yourself. Eh, go ahead, do your worst.
It'll be easy, like breaking an icicle.
Try me.
Wintup leaps toward Bjork until he knocks Wintup into the snow. Bjork charges at him. Wintup bites his neck and scrapes him with his claws. Bjork and Wintup stand on their two legs, biting and scraping each other until Wintup jumps on Bjork's chest, still biting on his neck and scratching his arms. Narrington grabs Wintup's ear with his claws and pulls it with all his might.
Unhand him, you demon.
Wintup knocks Narrington in the snow with his arm and continues to bite his neck. Anya comes in and knocks Wintup over with her spear.
Anya, what are you doing?
Fitting you.
Anya keeps hitting, swinging, and pointing her spear at Wintup as the white wolf keeps biting and scraping at her. Wintup pounces on her while she is still holding her spear, blocking her face as Wintup keeps biting at her until she pushes him off her chest. Narrington scratches the white wolf with his claws. Bjork grabs Wintup by the tail and tosses him away from Anya as the wolf lands on the snow.
Come on, we've got to get out of here.
Anya quickly climbs on his back, and Bjork runs through the blizzard. Wintup slowly gets up off the snow and sees Bjork running with Anya on his back. Wintup makes a diabolically evil glare on his face with his eyebrows meeting in the middle.
You're not getting away that easily, my boy, because one way or another, you, the owl, and your precious little human will be destroyed.
Wintup howls at the sky, and the scene switches to Bjork running down the slope on four legs with Anya on his back. Narrington flies along them as they rush through the blizzard.
Oh, dear God, that was so life-threatening.
Anya, you shouldn't have done that. You almost got yourself killed.
Hey, just because I'm a princess doesn't mean I can't fight. And hello, I saved your life. And if it wasn't for me, you still could have been the White Wolf's murder victim. Ever thought about that?
Yeah, you do have a point there. Thanks for saving me, though.
No problem. Wow.
The blizzard stops and clears away as Bjork walks up to the high point of the slope and sees the northern lights moving in the sky with its bright, vibrant, beautiful colors.
It's so amazing.
Extraordinary.
Yeah, it is. I think this would be a way to get you home.
Well, what are we waiting for? Let's go.
Bjork jumps off the top of the slope and runs through the Arctic with Narrington flying ahead of them, following the northern lights.
I'm so glad that we don't even have to worry about...
Bjork stops and sees Wintup on top of a steep hill on his right. Narrington lands on his back.
Wintup, I thought I told you back off and leave us alone.
Wintup laughs maniacally and sinisterly as a pack of 1,000 wolves appear up on the hill where he is, joining him.
Okay, now I really need to get home.
Yeah, no kidding.
Bjork runs to the other side of the Arctic. Wintup and his pack charge at Bjork as the polar bear runs and slides down the hill.
Some polar opposites they turn out to be.
Anya is still riding on his back and looks behind her.
You know, it's not every day that you see a fleet of 1,000 wolves trying to kill us.
Believe me, princess, they don't always do this for food. In fact, they keep doing this for sport.
Bjork runs straight into the gorge. Interior gorge day. The wolves run closer and closer to Bjork. One of the wolves on his left jumps at Anya and she knocks it over with her spear. Another one tries to get off her back by biting her shoe. Anya then kicks the wolf off her shoe. Wintup pounces her off Bjork's back as Bjork slides down the hill.
Bjork!
Anya,
we finish this now.
Wintup unsheathes his claws and raises his paw in the air. Bjork rushes up the hill and approaches the pack.
Hey, Wintup.
Bjork swipes the white wolf away from her and gives Anya a lift on his back. Bjork slides down the hill with Narrington flying next to them.
Oh, thank God you're okay. Are they still gaining on us?
Anya looks behind her and sees the whole pack charging at them.
Do I even have to answer?
Well, at least it can't get any worse.
Bjork stops sliding and hears a big booming noise in the distance and turns his head, seeing a giant avalanche heading down the mountain toward them.
You just had to be predictable, don't you?
Well,
Yeah, I hate being red all the time.
Bjork runs away from the avalanche as the wolves still chase them. The avalanche moves behind the wolves as the pack runs faster and faster. Bjork sees a glacier-filled cave in the distance and runs toward it.
Through there.
Why?
I've got an idea.
Wintook and his pack follow Bjork into the cave as they run past the avalanche. Interior, glacier cave, day. Bjork keeps running toward the frozen river and slides into the wall. The cave begins to shake as the wolf pack rushes into the cave.
Oh dear.
All right, we've got to get out of here.
Bjork rushes out of the frozen river and rushes straight toward the exit. The icicles and glaciers fall off the ceiling and crush all the other wolves, one by one. Bjork runs side to side to avoid getting crushed.
We're not going to make it.
Wintook still chases Bjork.
You will be my princess.
Wintook pounces toward Anya in slow motion until Bjork turns his body around and punches the white wolf in the stomach, which pushes him back into the falling glaciers. Exterior, mountain cliff, day. Bjork quickly runs out of the cave with the glaciers falling behind him, and the white owl rides on his back.
Hold on.
Bjork jumps off the cliff and dives into the Arctic Bay. Bjork grabs onto a blue whale's back as it swims up to the surface. The whale rises out of the water, flying in the air until it comes down, floating on the water. Bjork, Narrington, and Anya are sitting on the whale's back and see the entire view of the Arctic.
Wow.
Anya sees a pod of whales rising and diving into the water.
Boy, this has been one crazy adventure, isn't it?
It sure is.
Bjork gets pushed up in the air by the whale's blowhole and falls on the other side of the whale's back. Bjork and Anya start to laugh innocently and smile at each other. Exterior, Arctic shore, day. The whale drops them off to the shore as they walk down the whale's fin.
Thanks, Shamu.
The whale nods and dives backwards toward the ocean.
So which way do we go now?
You'll see. It's a surprise.
Bjork and Anya walk up the hill and see an Inuit village ahead of them. Anya gasps with excitement.
It's the village. I'm home. Oh, thank you so much.
Anya hugs Bjork on his chest, and Bjork hugs her back. She kisses him on his nose. Bjork begins to blush, smiling with his cheeks turning red.
Well, it's nothing really, but you're welcome.
Well, see you out there.
See you out there, Anya.
Farewell, Your Highness.
Bjork walks away with Narrington, and Anya rushes into the village. The villagers start to rejoice her arrival. Bjork walks up the slope with Narrington flying at the same pace as Bjork.
Well done, my girl. Well done, my boy. I am as every bit as proud of you as your father would be.
I guess I am meant for this role after all.
Now let's get you some fish and find you a mate. You've earned it.
Bjork and Narrington run straight toward the shore with the sun setting in the distance. Fade out. So it's a really big part of having learning to write is to have your scripts listened to, so thank you for being part. If you have any comments for Travis, let him know after the showcase today. Thank you.
We have two more presentations to go, mine and Professor Paul Marriage is going to have a live reading from his acting students. 15 minutes of quick, we'll be done. This is last semester's work, Advanced Television Studio Production. In this class, students are writing and producing their own video segments, 3 minute scenes. Caroline Newman, I guess, seems to be the star today. She did a parody of the show Mama's House. I don't know if you're familiar with the show Mama's House with Carol Burnett. It's about a family that's really quite loud, although they love each other very much. And they're always arguing with each other. She pitched the idea to us to the class, and we decided to do a parody in the TV studio. Now, the first clip we're going to show you is the actual scene itself, and then after that, we're going to show you another clip of what's going on in the control room while the scene is happening live. What the technical director's doing, the director, Caroline, the audio person, the assistant director, what they're doing as well. So it's not just what you see on camera, what I'm going to show you now, it's what's happening behind the scenes. So why don't you play this clip?
You just wink it off that dang contraction of yours and come howling with this thing.
It's called a laptop, and that there is a cell phone with a 14th time long.
Well, I can't seem to figure out how to reply to this message here. If I would even call this message with all these grammar and spelling mistakes from all the little rascals of yours.
It's called texting, Mama, and that's how they do it nowadays. Look, Bubba just sent you a funny gift. What would you say in reply?
Well, how the hell should I know?
Hey, get in here!
grandfather. I thought I got rid of this nonsense when he died. You were just like him. I knew I shouldn't have agreed to get one of these things. I still make phone calls on these. I mean, people do still talk on the phone, right? Unlike all these great blue-eyed children of yours.
This is my house and my children, and I will raise them any way I want, Mama.
And that's your fourth beer today.
And let me tell you something, I've needed every last one of them.
Oh, Vicky just shared something on Facebook.
Who cares about Vicky Hart? All you ever talk about is that idiot Vicky Hart.
Oh, come on now, you just let Vicky Hart to go over. Besides, he tagged me in a video from that old variety show. What was the name of it?
Oh, the Carol Burnett Show? Oh, let me see. I hope it's the one about the elephant story.
That Tim Conway sure is one funny fella.
Go to the behind-the-scenes clip. All right, so that's what we watched, right? But now you're going to see what goes on in the control room while this is unfolding live.
Hey,
straight raw footage. Straight raw.
Ready, black? Think black. Quiet in the studio. Ready to fade in two, fade in sound. Fade in two, fade in sound. Ready one, Q channel. Speed. Speed.
Good. We got that dang tractors and come howling with this thing.
Three.
It's called a laptop, and that there is a cell phone. But the phone seems tiny.
Take one.
Well, I can't seem to figure out how to reply to this message here. If I would even call this message, with all these random and bellowing things from all those little graphs in here.
Take three.
It's called texting, Mama, and that's how they do it nowadays.
Ready one?
Look, Bob just sent you a funny gift. What would you say, Mama?
Take one.
Well, how the hell should I know?
Ready to?
Hey, get in here!
Have Amy walk a little bit further behind the bar when she walks out.
Would you mind explaining to Mama how texting works? I'm the beast. Where are you going? You come back here. I swear you were just like your father. I thought I got rid of this nonsense when he died. You were just like him.
Ready, three.
I knew I shouldn't have agreed to get one of these things. I still make phone calls on these. I mean, you people do still talk on the phone, right? I'm like all these great blue-eyed children of yours.
Take three.
This is my house and my children, and I will raise them any way I want, Mama.
Take two.
And that's your fourth beer today.
And let me tell you something, I've needed every last one of them.
Ready, one. Take one.
Oh. Vicky just shared something on
Vicky. Three.
Who cares about Vicky Hart? All you ever talk about is that idiot Vicky Hart.
Oh, come on, you just let Vicky Hart to go over. Besides, you tagged me in a video blooper from that old variety show. What was the name of it?
Oh, the Carol Burnett Show? Oh, let me see. I hope it's
fade to black, fade out sound.
That Tim Conway sure is one funny fella.
Fade to black, fade out sound.
Alright. So you see, that's an observational. Ooh. Yeah. That's an observational. That's an observational documentary camera. That's unedited completely. But the actual scene was also unedited. It was a live soap opera style scene, a fictional narrative. Now, the next thing I'm going to take you to is a field production class where students shoot with the intention to edit the footage. This footage wasn't shot with the intention of being edited. This was a complete story by itself. This field production class is the first time that students are working outside of a studio. They have to deal with lighting that changes constantly. They have to deal with sound that interrupts their scene. They have to deal with camera or people walking in and out of a shot in the background. It's outside the laboratory, really. You have no control or little control. That's how come whenever you see a film being shot on location in the streets of New York, you know, they corner off the whole street, they block things, they put artificial lights, they have security, they have a food truck. It's basically to have as much control as possible out on location. The whole, shooting in the studio is great because you're in a laboratory and you can control everything, but you lose the realness, the element of reality, like in the previous scene. But so the next thing is field production class, and in this class it's great because I get the opportunity to not bother the students with telling them what to do so much, but I've got in front of the camera on purpose so they have to direct me, which means it's a bit of a chore because I'm the professor and they don't want to say the wrong thing, but I don't know what I'm doing or where I'm going unless the student director tells me, look here, look there, speak louder, speak lower, and so it's a nice role reversal. And you'll recognize the script because Professor Mishevitz used the script in his class for editing, and it came from my class, and I use it in this class. But this is something that Students are not required to edit in this class. However, students do edit in this class because they want to put shots together to see how the overall piece is going to look. So Karen, wave Karen, Karen decided to take a couple of these scenes and put them together so we have more of a story. And then after that, I sat with Karen and I said, why don't we show them the slated scenes, in other words, the raw footage and how it goes together really very quickly. So that's what we're going to play right now. There are two scenes back to back. Go ahead.
Are you sure you answered all the questions? You know you don't want to leave any blanks on the multiple choice test.
Yeah, it's all there.
So glad you passed. Now you come out with this.
So how'd you do? I don't know. I think I did okay.
What do you mean okay? Didn't you study?
Yeah, for some of the questions. I don't know.
You have my notes. Come on, you should at least pass.
Yeah, but I missed a few classes. I just hope I pass.
Yeah, I'm sure you did fine. Don't worry. Come on, let's go get lunch. My treat.
Your treat?
Yeah. So each shot is edited together, not like the TV studio where it's recorded live. Now you're going to see it deconstructed with the slates in the shot. There you go.
Test results, scene one, take six, long shot. Test results, scene one, take four, over the shoulder student.
Are you sure you answered all the questions? Because you don't want to make any delays on the test.
Test results, scene one, take 11.
Test results, scene two, take eight, long shot.
So how'd you do?
Test results, scene two,
long shot. I don't know. I think I did okay.
Wait, are you okay? Didn't you study? Get my notes. Come on. You should at least pass.
Test results, scene two, take eight, long shot.
Yeah, I missed a few classes. I'm still about pass.
Yeah, I'm sure you did fine. Don't worry about it. Come on, let's go to lunch. My treat.
Your treat? We out.
So it took the whole class session just to shoot one segment. It was me in the classroom as a teacher. And then it took another class session to shoot the other section with Shaquille and Matthew in front of the computer. And then it took another class or two with Karen editing the pieces together. And every little thing you saw or you heard, you know, was Karen manipulating the images and manipulating the elements to make the story make you laugh or to make the story have some sort of sense. And again, this script is used over and over again. Professor Misevich used it in the other class for the editing class so they can play around with it and deconstruct it even more to show you how many ways one idea, one scene, one script could be shot to mean different things. So I hope you enjoyed that little bit of television production. Up next is Professor Palmieri, who teaches our theater track. Please welcome Professor Palmieri. Professor Paul Mary has a group of students that are going to do some...
Yes.
You're on?
Okay. So I know you've been here a while, so I'll get to the treat that I have for you. Two of our students going to perform for you just brief speeches from a couple plays. Elements of Theater is the class that is running right now. And really, it's a comprehensive course in the basics of what I would call play preparation, performance preparation. Using what I might consider, Olivia, maybe you'd agree, the easiest textbook in higher education today, we touch on the origins and conventions of this art form that has evolved for thousands of years, and review what it takes to build a character, to organize a rehearsal process, what goes on between an audience and a performance, It's a very, very unique and special, powerful art form, part of the reason it's been around for so long. I just personally just love doing this. The college is where I discovered a love for theater. I was out that window. That's where I would have been, the baseball field, really, before I realized how much I loved theater. And I didn't know that until I took a course in it in college. So it's really delightful for me to be doing this here at Mercy. I'm brand new, by the way. I didn't even know where this room was today. So I'm just glad I made it here. There's an emphasis on performance in this course. We do three basic performance projects across the semester, one being a dramatic or comic monologue that we try to bring to really a professional audition level, usually three minutes, basically, monologue. Then we move into a partnered scene from a play. We're doing short scenes from a play called Months on End by Craig Pospisil. We're finishing that unit now. And finally, we do a unit with classical acting, Shakespeare speaking Elizabethan verse using sonnets. And that's a whole lot more fun than it sounds, I promise you. But I gotta say, you know, in a school of liberal arts, I don't know that there's a course or there's a track that could be more helpful in whatever you choose to do with your life. I was just talking to Danielle when she arrived, and tell that story. Where were you, and what did that person say to you?
I was at the career fair, and I spoke with someone who's the district attorney. She works in the district attorney's office in White Plains, and she said, "Well, you're a media major, but I like you, and something about your presence and something about the way you speak. Send me a resume."
And Danielle's first thought was, that's because of elements of theater, right? But you see how an awareness of how one presents oneself, right? How one speaks. We do emphasize voice in the class, certainly. Voice training, classical voice training, I feel is very important and a big part of my responsibility as an instructor in speech here. Today we have Danielle Gray and Reyes Betancourt, who's also doing an amazing job spearheading a new drama club on campus, which is really coming along, and I urge all of you to get involved in that. It's just a wonderful university experience to have something to do with a play while you're here. I can promise you that you'd be glad you did it. Heidi, some of the members are here today. So we have Danielle doing a speech from Richard Fisher's Funeral, and then Reyes doing his speech, Picasso Reincarnated. Is that it? All right, great. So I'm going to stand in the back to encourage them to be loud as can be, filling the room with sound, breathing from the diaphragm, and performing these characters that they've developed very carefully this semester. Danielle Gray.
Performing Drew's monologue from Richard Fisher's Funeral by the playwright Kelly Powell.
You don't get it! I've been afraid of my father all my life. I spent every waking moment trying to keep him from exploding, trying to do everything just right. And not just believing, but knowing one day he would kill me. He'd kill us all. My first memory is the day my brother spilled a can of paint down the stairs. My parents were painting the house. Ricky thought he was helping, but it was too heavy for him, and paint just went flying everywhere. I held my breath. I don't know why I thought that would help. My father put his fist through the wall. I screamed, Ricky and I started crying, and the whole time he kept yelling at us to stop crying. I couldn't. I thought he was gonna kill us both, and my mother couldn't stop him. I was 4 years old. Ricky was two.
Sorry.
I've been living in that hole in the wall ever since. I can't forgive him. I won't pretend. So go read Footprints in the Sand if it'll make you feel all warm and fuzzy inside. Today my father's going in the ground. I can't remember having a father. A father couldn't do that to his kids.
Reincarnated by Joseph Arno. So I was walking around for 2 days thinking I was Picasso, when really what I was a major jackass. I went to this store out on Long Island, Michael's, and spent a couple of $100 on supplies. I was so serious about it, I bought 3 large canvases, brushes, paints, paint cleaner, spray paint, and markers. Don't ask me why, but markers. I went to the bookstore, bought a few $50 books on Basquiat and pop art, and I was doing all this reading and researching. I actually began feeling like I had a calling. I set up shop in my backyard, right against this big, beautiful tree. I tore open the paints, I squeezed red and yellow paint into my palette. I dipped one of my brushes into my palette. I look up and into the canvas, and it hit me. I asked myself as I stared at this large, white canvas, what the fuck am I doing? It's like a spell had been broken. I felt silly, and I started looking around and into the windows of neighbors' houses because I felt like I was being watched. And sure enough, there she was, a little girl named Megan, peering at me through a second floor story bedroom window. She had the look of disgust written across her face. So kind of, I don't know, not feeling inadequate in front of this child, I decided to prove to her that I could paint. It was as if I needed this child's approval. Don't ask me why, maybe I'm just crazy, but I did. I wanted this kid to say, good job, Joe. You're a fucking Picasso, all right. See.
I thought that was wonderful, Mark. Professor Palmer, can you say anything?
Thank you very much. I'll see you in theater-related class.
I want to thank you all for attending the Media Studies Showcase. I want to thank the faculty and the students for collaborating to put on this event. And we do this every year during the fall semester. And so it's just a wonderful time, and I hope you come back again. We have this room for another half hour or so till 2:30. So there's more food, so you can spend the time having more food and socializing, I hope. And I can talk to you and find out more about you. But thank you very much for attending the Media Studies Showcase, and have a good day.